In this video, what I am going to tell you about, actually I have taken this topic from the Engineering Mechanics book written by R.C. Hibbler. So what we are going to do, actually we have already done equilibrium analysis for the 2D diagrams. So how we have done over there in the previous videos, I have already told you. So in this video, what I am going to tell you, how can you sort it out Cartesian vector forms for the 3D equations and for the 3D diagrams. So in this video, what I am going to tell you about the Cartesian vectors and how can you solve the 3D numericals and how can you find out the angles for the 3D medium. Actually, we all know that we don't have 2D practically, so it does not exist. So what will happen, actually we have 3D in our houses if you want to see an example. So like what it be? For example, let me discuss with you here that what is the scenario. For example, if we see the corner of our room, so you will see there are the three lines. And what does it represent? This is the corner of your room. So if it is corner of your room, so what will happen over here, that let me tell you, is that what this is the vertical and this one is the horizontal and this one is also the horizontal. And now we have to name it the axes. And how can we name it? Whatever the variable you want to denote with it, it's like, for example, I'm taking this as x-axis, this one is the y-axis, and this one is the z-axis. So what will happen over here, that for instance, if this is upward z, so the downward will be minus z. So let me rub the arrow over here. So I don't want to tell you that it's a force. Actually, I just want to explain you the axis. So for example, I am taking green color over here. So this is minus z axis. And if it is x axis, so this will be, left side will be what? Minus x axis. And when you go back, so it will be your minus y axis. So in the, for example, in the R.C. Hibbler book, so they have taken and they have named it like this. So we will discuss it accordingly, but it's completely up to you. You are not forced to take the same axis what R.C. Hibbler is taking. So obviously we will do numerical accordingly. So if you want to change the name of your axis, you can change it. It's not a big deal or it's not a problem. For example, this is y-axis. It is taking y-axis. This one is the x-axis and this one is the z-axis. And these three are the positive one. This is positive and this one is positive. So what? Let me tell you here. Is that I am going to the red color and this is showing that is minus x axis and this one is minus z axis and this one is your minus y axis. So if it is your right, on the right hand side, if you have positive y axis, so what does it mean by that? On the left hand side, you have negative y axis. And if you are taking positive z-axis upward, so there will be negative z-axis below. So what does it mean by that? This is the corner and this corner, obviously that is the origin. And this origin will be what? Let me rub it. I did a mistake over here because I am using mouse over here. And this is what, for example, I am going to take the black pointer. And this is origin O and the origin O lies 0, 0, 0, this one. So this is the way you can denote your axes. And if these are axes, so what does it mean by that? You have to take next I am going to take another color, and for example, I'm taking this is green color. So if this is x-axis, so this will be I cap. This is I cap, and this is j cap. This is j cap, and this one is the k cap. So z will be represented with the k cap. This is the Cartesian form. And y-axis should be represented as j-cap, and x-axis should be represented as i-cap. And you can see in this diagram over here, what is happening over here. You easily watch the same thing what I have told you or explained it over here. So you can see if there, if this point is A, so A, Y, J, A, X, I, A, Z, K. So let me rub all the mesh what I have done over here. So I am going to rub it. And after listening to this, you hopefully you will be cleared with the 3D. So what is written over here? And I'm taking red pointer, and Cartesian vector representations will be three components of vector A. Act in the positive I cap, J cap, and K cap direction. So it will be like, for example, when I have to write down vector A, so what it will be vector A? Vector A has three components, because vector A is this one. This is vector A force, and it has three components when it is lying on the three axes. So it will be AXI, AYJ, and AZK. So it will be sum up. So you will get the component vector A, and vector A is divided or is break up, is broken up or break up into three components, X, Y, and J. X, Y, and Z, you can say. Note the magnitude and direction of each components are separated using vector algebraic operations. So obviously here we have to apply vector addition. A vector law over here. So I am moving towards the next slide, and we will discuss it more in detail, and we will do numerical on this topic as well. So here it is the next slide, and you can see here that is the Cartesian vector representation, and it will be represented like this. I already told you in the previous slide, and this is the diagram. When you have any vector force on the 3D plane, so what will happen? It has three components, ij, and the magnitude of Cartesian vector will be what? Ax square plus ay square plus az square whole under root by Pythagoras theorem. So we have done in the 2D as well, so hopefully it is cleared up till now. So I am moving towards the next slide and what it is about. And you, if you are looking here, so you can see what is this U. This is the unit vector. I already told in my vector video where I told you what is unit vector. Unit vector is dimensionless and it shows the direction. So unit vector of A is cos alpha I plus cos beta J plus cos gamma of K. From here, we can also derive the relationship cos square alpha plus cos square beta plus cos square gamma equals to 1. So what will happen over here? You can see what is happening. What is going on here? So let me tell you. In this video or in this picture, you can see over here that unit vector will be represented by this for the 3D form. For the 3D dimensions diagrams, and from where you can derive the relationship cos square alpha plus cos square beta plus cos square gamma equals to 1. And you can see this diagram, what is happening over here. You can see this is the AX and this one the vector A, and this is its component vector AX. So component of vector A is on the X component. So what is happening over here? You can see here that, let me tell you with my pointer, so it will be more clear and understandable for you. For example, you can see here that what is happening. It is 90 degrees. So if it is 90 degrees, so this one is angle alpha. So when it is alpha, so what will happen? You can write down cos alpha base upon hypotenuse. What is base? AX upon A is your base upon hypotenuse. So you can put cos alpha over here AX in place of AX upon A. Same goes here. You can see here what is happening. There is 90. It is making 90 degree with the Y axis and it is beta. So cos beta equals to AY over A base upon hypotenuse. And here goes, you can see AZ upon A is equals to cos of gamma, cos gamma. So that's why we are writing over here cos alpha, cos beta, and cos of gamma. So here we go. Now moving towards the next one. And here you can see. So how can I write it down? What I told you in the previous slide. Coordinate directions angles. So it will define the direction of A by the coordinate direction angles alpha, beta, or gamma, and measured between the tail of A and positive XYZ axis, provided they are located at the tail of A. Note that regardless of where A is directed, each of these angles will be between 0 degree and 180 degree. To determine alpha, beta, and gamma, consider the projection of A onto the XYZ axis, referring to the colored right triangles shown in the figure we have. So you can see what I told you in the previous slide, that why we are writing cos alpha equals to AX over A, cos beta is equals to AY over A, and cos gamma is equals to AZ over A. These numbers are known as the direction cosines of A. So whenever written in the question, you have to find out the cosine direction angles or coordinate direction angles or direction cosines. So you have to find out cos alpha, cos beta, cos of gamma. Once they have been obtained, the coordinate direction angles alpha, beta, gamma can then be determined from the inverse cosines. So obviously it will go here and it will become cos inverse and we will be able to calculate alpha. So same goes with the cos beta and same goes with the cos gamma. So let's move to the next one. And what is happening over here? So here goes the question. And this is the example from the book which I have taken. So how can we have to solve it out? Let me explain this question. So you have this question. You can see this one. And I am taking, for example, this one. Color. And this is the diagram given in the question. And this is the problem statement given in the question. So you have to consider first these two things. First of all, you have to read the problem statement. Two forces are acting on the hook shown in the figure. Specify the coordinate direction angles of F2 so that the resultant force Fr acts along the positive y-axis and has a magnitude of 800 newton. So what does it mean by that? It is asking that what you have to find out, you have to find out the coordinate direction angles of F2. And I am going to take another pointer color, that is the red one. And we have to find out the coordinate direction angles F2. So what it will be? Cos of alpha 2, cos beta 2, and cos of gamma 2. So this is the thing which we have to find it out. This is the required one. And the next thing is what? So that the resultant force, I am not looking on the diagram. Right now, I'm just reading the problem statement. So that the resultant force Fr acts along the positive y-axis. So you can see over here what is given in the question. In the question that it is saying that resultant force is acting on the y-axis. So what does it mean by that? If a vector force F, resultant force F is lying on the y-axis. So what does it mean by that? It has I and J component 0. So what does it mean by that? J component some must be there. But 0 dot I plus I don't know the value of J plus 0 dot K. So this is the scenario. This is not okay. This is 0 dot K Cartesian product. So What does it mean by that? We should know the value of j. How can we know that? And it is given in the question. You can read here, has a magnitude of 800 newton. So magnitude of f is given to us is 800 newton, and it is acting on the y-axis. So y must be the value it has. So I can write it down. So I am going to take another pointer color to differentiate it. So for example, here it will be 800J. This one. So one thing I just want to clear you. For example, when we are working on the XY axis, this is X axis and Y axis. And we have the point over here. And for example, this is 2. And this one is 2. So the components or coordinates of this point will be 2, 2 because x and y is 2. But in the case, for example, or for instance, you have the point at where you have the point here. And if this is the point and it is its value is 4, for example, here. And this is x and this one is y. So what does it mean by that? This point y component coordinate is 0 and x is 4. So 4 comma 0, I should have to write it down here. And if any point lies on y axis, so what does it mean by that? It means that if it is 4, it is lying at 4. So what does it mean by that? X component is 0 and its coordinate y is 4. So this is the way we have to find out the coordinates according to the axis. So same goes over here. When you have force lying on the axis, on any axis, so what does it mean by that? If it is lying on x axis, so the value of f is obviously it is having x-axis value, but the other axis values will be 0. For example, if any point is lying on y-axis, so it has y component, but x and z component will be 0. If any point is lying on the z component or z-axis, so what will happen? What we will say? X and y components are 0, but the value of z should be there. So this is the way we have to find out the values. For example, how can we solve the solution and how can we solve it out this type of numerical? And when you read the problem statement, now we are moving towards the diagram. What is the diagram? And you can see over here in the diagram that there is a hook. This one is your hook. And there are the two forces acting over it, F1 and F2. F1 is equals to 300 newton and F2 equals to 700 newton. And you can see the angles are coming out from F1. How is it possible? And how can you identify it? Whether the angles are for which? For F1, for F2. You can see over here. Let me tell you. Look here. The angle of F1 is given with respect to x-axis here. So the angle of with respect to x-axis for F1, so it will be alpha 1 equals to 45 degree. And if you see here, there is an angle in between F1 and y-axis, so it will be beta 1 equals to 60 degree. Then the angle between z axis and F1, it will be gamma 1. So 120 degree is for F1 force and that is gamma because it is connected with the z axis, but we don't know the angles of F2 and we have to find it out. And the value of F2 is given to us, the magnitude of F1 and F2 is given to us, that is 300 newton for F1. And the magnitude or F2 is given to us 700 newton. Now I am going to solve this numerical. So solution to solve this problem, the resultant force Fr and its two components F1 and F2 will each be expressed in Cartesian vector form. Then as shown in figure 232b, it is necessary that Fr equals to F1 plus F2. And we have for finding out the resultant force or finding out F2 force or the coordinate direction angles of F2, what we have to do? We have to sum up F1 and F2 equals to Fr. But it is not simplified easily because it is not the scalar quantity. It is a vector quantity. So how can we solve it out? Let's start. First of all, what you have to do? Let me tell you. In the first equation, what we are going to do here, this is F1 and F1 will be like this. F1x, it is equals to F1x. F1x and this one is F1y and this one is F1z. So what we have to do, F1x is equals to F1 cos alpha 1 because I have already told you cos alpha is equals to F1x upon F1 in the previous slide. So what does it mean by that? So F1x will be equals to F1 cos of alpha. So I can easily write in place of F1x that F1 cos alpha 1 I cap. Then plus F1 cos beta 1 j cap. You want to use cap, you can use it. But in the R.C. Hibbler book, it is represented as in the form of bold. So it is understood that it is I cap, j cap, k cap. And then for F1z, F1 cos gamma 1 and F1 cos beta 1. Same goes with cos alpha, cos beta, cos gamma. What you have to do, you know the value of F1. F1 magnitude is given to us, that is 300 Newton. And we know the value of alpha 1, that is 45 degree. So what we have to do, we have to put 300 in place of F1 and we have to put 45 degree for alpha 1. So this is the way 300 cos of 45 degree plus 300 cos of 60 degree because beta 1 is equals to 60 degree plus in place of F1 that there is 300 into cos of 120 degree cos of gamma 1. So gamma 1 is equals to 120 degree. So you can see over here. Now what you have to do, use your calculator and you have to multiply 300 into cos 45 degree. So you will get this value. You will get this value. And when you multiply 300 into cos 60 degrees, so you will get 150. And when you multiply 300 cos of 120 degrees, so you will get minus 150. So you have to use your calculator. Now you get F1 force into the IJK form in the Cartesian vector form. So it is coming out to be Newton. So for F2, what you have to do? F2 equation will be F2xi plus F2yj. Plus F2ZK. When I expand it, so what will happen? F2 cos of alpha 2. But I don't want to expand it because I don't know the value of alpha 2, beta 2 and gamma 2. But just I know just which value. I just know the value of F2, magnitude of F2. So what we have to do, we have to sum up F1 plus F2 equals to Fr, and Fr is equals to, I already told you in the start of the problem statement that Fr will be equals to 800J because its I and K component is zero. So it will be 800J. So it is in Newton. So since the resultant force has a magnitude of 800 Newton and acts in the plus J direction, so Fr is equals to 800J equals to 800J into Newton. So this is the way. Now we know the values of F1 in the Cartesian vector form and we know the value of resultant force in the Cartesian vector form. Then what we have to do, we have to put the equation here where in this equation F1 and then in F2, we will put this equation, this one, and we have to put the equation in Fr. So how can we do that? I will tell you in the next slide. Now, what we have done up till now, actually, there was Azan time. So I am moving to the next one. And now we know that F1 and F2 and FR. So what we have to put in the next slide. So let's go. So what is happening over here? You can see in this diagram, we require FR equals to F1 plus F2. What we have, what are the equations? We got it, FR equals to 800J. So what does it mean by that? 0 dot I cap plus 0 dot K. 0 dot K. So, and the, in place of F1, we have to put 212.1 I cap plus 150 J cap minus 150 K cap. And in place of F2, what we have to put this equation. F2XI plus F2YJ plus F2ZK. And in place of F1, what we need this equation. So what we have to do. So what we have to do, we have to sum up. So how can we sum up? So we have to sum up X component with X component, Y component with Y components, I component with I components, J component with J components, and K components with K components. So you can see over here is 212.1 I cap plus F2X. So we have to sum up like this. Let me show with my another color pointer, use it. So it will be clear to all of you. So 212 will be sum up with F2X, 150 will be sum up with F2Y, and minus 150 will be sum up with F2Z. So you can see over here 212.1 plus F2X in bracket I cap plus 150 plus F2YJ cap plus minus 150 plus F2Z K cap equals to 0 dot I plus 800J plus 0 dot K. So we have to compare it as we have, you have done in your intermediate, in your grade 11 or 12. So to satisfy this equation, the IJ components of FR must be equal to the corresponding IJK components of F1 plus F2 hands. So we have to take, let me choose what another pointer color. You have to equate this equation equals to 0 dot I. So you have to compare it. So 0 equals to 212.1 plus F2X, and F150 plus F2Y is equals to 800. So you have to sum up like this, and then you have minus 150 plus F2Z is equals to 0. So it will be like this. So what you have to do, F2X is equals to minus 212.1 Newton, F2Y is equals to 650 Newton over here, and F2Z is equals to, this one is Z, F2Z is equals to 150 Newton. So you have to simplify these equations and you will get the value of F2X, F2Y, F2Z. So this will be the I component, this is J component, and this is K component of vector force F2. So how can I write it down, this F vector force F2? So let me tell you here, F2 vector force in the form of IJK, I can write it down like this, minus 212.1 I cap plus 650 J cap plus 150 K cap. So this will become the equation of our vector force in the IJK component force, vector force F2. So now what you have to do, you have to find out the magnitude of F2. Now it is very simple. You have to take coefficients of I, J and K and you have to square it. So you, here you can see, I put it here minus 212 square plus 650 square for the Y component plus 150 square, and you have to take under root. And you will get the magnitude of force F2, and it is coming out to be 700 Newton. And it is already given in the question, so there is no need of it. So we are just trying to prove it out. And then what you have to do, if you know the magnitude of F2, so what if you don't want to find it out the magnitude of F2, so it's not a big deal or it's not a big problem. So it is, if it is already given in the question, so there is no need to find it out. If it is not given in the question, so you need to find it out. So in the next step, what you have to do, you have to find out the coordinate direction angles. And how can you do that? So when you are, I am coming over here, you can see cos alpha 2 is equals to, I am talking here, cos alpha 2 is equals to, is equals to what? F2x upon F2, vector force F2. So you will put the value of minus 212.1 divided by 700, magnitude of F2 is 200, 700. So alpha 2, you have to apply cos inverse over here. You have to bring this cos here and cos inverse upon, into this. So you will get the value alpha 2 is equals to 108 degree. Cos beta 2 will be what? 650 upon 700, because it is equals to F2y upon vector F2, vector F2. So 650 upon 700 cos inverse into 650 upon 700. So you will get beta 2. And in the next step, cos gamma 2. So you will get gamma 2. Gamma 2 is equals to 150 upon 700, because it is F2z divided by F2 is equals to, coming out to be gamma 2. When you apply cos inverse, so you will get gamma 2 is equals to 77.6 degrees. So this is the way to solve these types of questions. So in the start, what we have done, we know the equation of FR. We can easily find out the equation of F1, because the coordinate direction angles or magnitude of F1 force was given in the question. And for F2, what will was happened if we just know the magnitude of F2 and we don't know the coordinate direction of coordinate direction angles of F2. So we have to find it out. So what we have done, FR equals to F1, 2. First, we sorted out the, find out the equation of FR, F1 and F2. Then we just simply sum it up. And when we sum it up, so what we have done, we have to compare the equation. And when we have compared the equation, so we have to compare the I, J, K. I with I component and J with J, J cap, K with K cap. And then what we have done, we have to find out the magnitude of F2. And you can see that the magnitude we get it and whatever the magnitude given in the question, both are same. So it means we have done correct calculation. And in the last step, what we have done, we through coordinate direction angles formula, we have calculated alpha 2, beta 2 and gamma 2 that was asking in the questions that is, that is required in the question that we have calculated. So let's go on the next slide. And here is another question. And what is it? It is very simple. So let's start reading this question. What is happening over here? So determine the magnitude and the coordinate direction angles of the resultant force acting on the ring. So you can see there are the two forces acting over here, and both the forces are given in the Cartesian vector force. And you can see F1 is given in the JK form. So it means that its I component is zero. So zero dot I cap. So what we have to do, obviously for the FR, what we have to do, FR is equals to F1 plus F2. F1 plus F2, and we have to put the Cartesian vector force of F1 and F2 here, and then we will get the FR. So here it is in the solution. You can see FR equals to summation of F equals to F1 plus F2. We can simply add it. These are the vectors and these are in the Cartesian vector form, so we can simply add it. So there is no need to convert it and use it unit vector form. So here is J and this is K. This is I, this is J and this is K. So what we have to do for the I, 50 plus 0 is here. Let me write it down. So if you find difficulty in it, so it will be clear to you, all of you. I cap 50 or 0 plus 50 plus 0, or you can write down 0 plus 50. It's the same thing. In the next, for the J, what it is? 60 minus 100 J cap. So it will comes out to be minus 40. You can see here, because minus is with the bigger value, and or you can say larger value. So the next value is what? 80 plus 100 for the K components. So you can see K coefficients are 80 plus 900. So it will be, let me drop this. I write it down by mistake, zero. So let me dub it. It is So done. So the answer comes out to be 50i minus 40j and 80 plus 100k. So 180k. And if you have to find out the resultant force, magnitude of resultant force, so 50 square minus 40 square plus 180 square, so whole under root, when you will get your answer, so you will get the magnitude of FR. And in this problem, you can also find out the coordinate direction angles of FR as well. And how can you do that? Obviously, you will get these value and this value. So 50 divided by 191, 40 divided by 191, 180 minus 40 divided by 191, 180 divided by 191. So you will get the alpha, beta and gamma here. And if someone is asking in the question that you have to find out the unit vector, so you can easily find it out as we have done earlier in the question. So let's move to the slide and let me write it down the values here. So it will be easier for you to find it out. For example, if you have to find out alpha, beta and gamma for force vector F. So cos alpha will be equals to 50 upon 191. And cos of beta is equals to minus 40. It is not asking in the question. I'm just giving you, if you, it is asked in the question, for example, it is in the paper, it is asking that, so you will be able to find it out. And then which value is there? 100 plus 180. 180 divided by 191. 191. So you will get alpha, beta and gamma for this question. So let's go. The coordinate direction angles, it is given, it is here, it is solved here, it will be clear what I have done over here. The same thing I have done in the previous slide, you can see it is solved for the unit vector. This is unit vector. Unit vector. And how can you find out unit vector, which I told you in the previous slide, that 50 upon 191, 40 upon 191, 180 upon 191. So you will get your these values and you have to equate it equals to cos alpha. It has to be equated as cos beta as it is done. And this is cos of gamma. So when you equate it, so you will get alpha, beta and gamma from here. So this is the way to find out the coordinate direction angles. So let's go for the next question. Before going there, and some students asked me for the in the my previous semesters that how can we see the 3D? So you can see here, this is minus y axis, this is positive y, and this one is the positive x axis, this is minus z. If this is minus z, so this will be positive z. If this is positive x, so this will be minus z.